diagnosis of doctor, of course, i-examine pa yung injured part, no, at doon magkakaroon ng tinatawag nga na diagnosis kung ano yung makikitang kind of injury doon sa iyong parte, no, ng katawan na injured. So yun yung pinagkaiba ni diagnosis tsaka ni injury evaluation. So yung injury evaluation is after the game, as in you're going to the doctor, or I mean to the hospital, just to, you know, have a very short check-up nung iyong injury or follow-up check-up, yung mga ganyan. So that is diagnosis. Now we have here the diagnosis process, accounts all the information needed to see a holistic picture of the cause and severity of the injury. So for the diagnosis process, right after, no, na ikaw ay mabigyan ng diagnosis doon or diagnostic doon sa tinatawag nating injury, papakitan sa'yo doon ng doctor kung gaano kalala yung injury mo, ilang araw kang kailangan magpahinga para makarecover doon sa injury, at marami pang iba. So all the details will be given to you nung doctor or nung physician. So for the evaluation process, this is to rule the presence of a severe injury or a life-threatening condition, how to transport the patient, and appropriate first aid while transporting the patient. Sa pagta-transport ng patient, marami tayong kinds of transport eh. At marami din tayong situation na pwedeng i-consider pag tayo ay magta-transport ng patient. Let's say for example, yung scene is unsafe. No? So we're going to pick, no, yung right way on transporting the patient. So marami pang dapat i-consider dito. Pero since we are just talking about sports injury, so ibig sabihin, this is during the game, no? Bigla kang nagkaroon ng injury. So kailangan natin na i-evaluate yung, of course, yung lugar, yung patient mismo, 'di ba? Yung scenario, kailangan nating i-evaluate yung mga 'yan. Now, we have here the primary survey. So this is a quick evaluation if there are life-threatening injuries that are present, and the evaluation needs to consider if the patient should be moved or transported immediately. Yeah. So for the primary survey, ito ay ginagawa, no, dahil nga meron tayong life-threatening injuries. Okay, so the evaluation needs to consider if the patient should be moved or transported immediately to a medical facility. So that is the primary survey. And usually we are doing the primary survey for the unconscious victim. No, when you say unconscious, yun nga, walang malay. So the sports injury that can lead to death. So what are those sports injuries? No, so yun yung iisa-isahin natin. So first one is traumatic brain injury. So of course, doon pa lang sa title, makikita na natin or maiisip kagad natin na yung ulo kagad, no, yung tinamaan dito sa injury na ito. So one of the life-threatening sports injury is concussion or traumatic brain injury. So it is common to contact and combat sports and is caused by a strong blow to the head that temporarily impairs brain function. So let's say for example, yung mga football, no, or rugby, yan yung mga kadalasan nagkakaroon ng mga players, no, na nagkakaroon ng traumatic brain injury because of a strong blow or strong impact, no, na nakukuha ng mga players. So yan yung isa sa mga life-threatening sports injury. Then we have three types of concussion. First one is grade 1 or yung mild. Then pagdating ng grade 2 is moderate. And yung grade 3 is severe. So isa-isahin natin, no? So two telltale signs of life-threatening condition. So ito yung mga dapat nating tingnan, no, para ma-consider natin yung isang condition as life-threatening. Number one is unconsciousness. So yun nga, kapag ka walang malay, if breathing and unconscious, no, do not move the body unless the neck and back is stabilized to prevent complications. Tatandaan natin, pagdating sa first aid or pagbibigay ng first aid, kung ang pasyente ay unconscious, hindi natin siya pwedeng basta-basta na lang galawin. Kahit nga conscious, hindi natin pwedeng basta-basta galawin. No, kasi baka mamaya makadagdag tayo ng injury palalo. Pero kung kailangan talaga nating ilipat yung pasyente, make sure that the neck and back is stable, no? Kasi yan nga yung ano natin, yung spinal column natin connected dun sa ating brain. So we must call emergency services and monitor your the vital signs of the patient until medical help arrives. So monitor mo yung kanyang blood circulation, yung kanyang airway kung siya ay humihinga, no? Monitor mo yung kanyang breathing, no? Or yung heartbeat, no? Or pulse rate, monitor natin yun. Kasi once na yun ay bumabagal or nag-abnormal, delikado yun, ano? Pwedeng yung pasyente ay tumigil yung tibok ng puso. So yan yung sa number one, unconsciousness. And number two is not breathing. So kung ang pasyente ay hindi humihinga at unconscious, kailangan na nating dumiretso sa tinatawag nating CPR, no? So syempre, habang nagaantay tayo ng medical help, kailangan natin madugtungan yung buhay ng pasyente. So CPR or cardiopulmonary resuscitation, yan ay kinocompose ng rescue breath tsaka ng hand compressions, no? Pero yun nga, ang rescue breath nowadays is hindi siya applicable because of yung mga nakakahawang sakit, no? So yan yung two telltale signs of life-threatening conditions if the patient is unconscious and not breathing. So cardiopulmonary resuscitation natin, or CPR, this is a life-saving technique, no? Useful in many emergencies, including a heart attack or near drowning in which someone's breathing or heartbeat has stopped. So kapag tumigil nga yung tibok ng puso, proceed tayo sa CPR. At ang mga karaniwan na pasyente na ginagamitan ng CPR is yun nga, yung mga inaatake sa puso, yung mga nalulunod, no, yung mga ganyan. So rescue breath and of course, again, the hand compressions is very important in doing the CPR. Now, how are we going to perform CPR? So these are the step-by-step procedure. So first one is placing the heel of one hand or your dominant hand. Let's say for example, for me, ang dominant hand ko is kanan, no? Kasi kanan yung lagi kong ginagamit. So ito yung heel ng aking kamay, yan yung gagamitin ko para ilagay sa top of the breastbone ng pasyente, no? At the level of nipple. So while the other hand is on top with fingers. So if this is my dominant hand, I'm going to put my another hand doon sa kanyang top, like this one, interlocking, no? Para meron tayong pwersa. Okay? So yan. At again, the best position, or the best location is yung top nung ating breastbone, no? Or yung sternum, kung tawagin. So the breastbone has to be compressed to a depth of 1.5 inch to 2 inches. So kailangan yung chest compression natin hindi sobrang lambot, hindi rin sobrang namang madiin, no? Kasi kapag mahina yung chest compression natin, hindi naman yun naabot, no? Dun sa ating, hindi, kasi ang goal natin sa chest compression, let's say for example, this is your heart, then this is the chest. Ang goal natin is ma-pump yung heart ulit, no? To pump blood. So yun yung goal natin. Ngayon, kung ihinaan mo lang yung chest compression mo, hindi siya aabot. So yun yung ano doon, yun yung factor doon. At pag sobrang lakas naman, syempre, baka mamaya mabasag naman natin yung breastplate or breastbone nung ating pasyente. So it should be in control, no? So compress the chest at a rate of 100 times per minute. And if willing, give rescue breaths every after 30 compressions. Again, rescue breaths is not applicable, especially kung hindi mo kakilala yung pasyente, no? Pero yun nga, kung kapamilya mo naman, syempre, if willing, you can give rescue breaths, no? Every after 30 compressions. So meron tayong cycle dyan. So chest compression, rescue breath, chest compression, rescue breath. So ganun ang ating cycle. Now, if you're going to proceed with the rescue breath, you're just going to seal the mouth with his or her mouth and pinch the nose before giving a rescue breath. Okay? So our goal naman dun is to give, of course, breathing dun sa ating pasyente. So the pinch of, on the nose is released to allow air to come out, and first responder gives another rescue breath after 1 second. So each cycle is comprised of 30 compressions and 2 rescue breaths. So the cycle should be performed over and over until the emergency medical services takes over. So kapag dumating na yung medical services, we can just give the patient sa medical services. Now, we have here the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or the HCM, this is a condition in which a portion of the heart becomes thickened, no, or yung kumakapal. So without an obvious cause, this results in the heart being less able to pump blood effectively. So yun yung HCM na tinatawag. Nahihirapan mag-pump or mag-function yung ating puso sa pagpapump ng blood. We also have here the Marfan syndrome. So it is a common preventable cause of sudden cardiac death in the athlete. So it is an autosomal dominant disorder of connective tissue with variable penetration that affects multiple organ systems, especially the aortic root aneurysm. Rupture or dissection is the most common cause of sudden death. So that is the Marfan syndrome. The next one after the primary survey, we have here the secondary survey. So for the secondary survey, this is performed if the patient is stable or as in conscious na siya, may malay na, gising na, nakakausap mo na. Again, yung primary survey, walang malay yung pasyente, hindi humihinga, life-threatening yung condition. Pero gagawin mo naman yung secondary survey kapag stable na yung iyong pasyente. So its goal is to determine the primary injury, severity, muscle function, and joint stability, as well as the location and mechanism of the injury. So since nakakausap mo na yung pasyente, you can do a secondary survey or kaunting questions or interview about his or her condition. So we have here the observation process. It is a passive component of secondary survey, which is usually performed visually and manually. The coach or trainer should inspect for deformity. So ito yung observation process, as in kapag ka ikaw ay na-injured during the game, papaupuin ka sa bench, i-observe ka ng coach mo or ng trainer, at titingnan nung coach mo kung nagkaroon ba ng deformity, let's say for example, sa muscle mo, sa buto, no? So if nagkaroon ba ng swelling, no, pamamaga, nag-iba yung kulay, let's say for example, parang naging violet or naging reddish yung kulay, bleeding and other possible signs of injury. So ganun yung observation process. Okay? So papaupuin ka, i-observe yung katawan mo, yung kamay mo, yung paa mo, no, kung nagkaroon ng malalang injury. So aside from visual inspection, which is yung ginawa nga, no, so the coach can palpate the possible injury site while looking at the reaction of the injured athlete. So the following questions can help when performing inspection. So kapag tayo, kung sakali man, no, tayo ay isang coach, pwede nating itanong to during the inspection. First one, how is the athlete position? So, ano ba yung kanyang position nung siya ay nung siya ay na-injured, no? Is there an obvious deformity? So, nagkaroon ba ng dislocated bone at kung ano-ano pa, bleeding, skin discoloration, and etc. So, are there unusual bumps and bruises? Baka may nagkaroon ng pasa, nagkaroon ng bukol. Is the bone and joint aligned normally? So yun nga, baka nagkaroon mamaya ng dislocation, no? And does the athlete complain of more pain when more pressure is applied? So let's say for example, ito yung naituon ng player no yung kanyang kamay. Tapos dinidiinan mo ng konti or naglalagay ka ng pressure dito sa part na ito at nakikita mo na mas habang dinidiinan mo, mas sumasakit. So yun, pwede nating itanong yung mga question na yun para makita natin kung yung player natin is totally injured. Okay? So, location of the injury. Another aspect of the survey is identifying the location of the injury. So, syempre, para mas madali mong makita yung injury nung iyong player or nung isang player, you must ask for the location. So, the location of the injury helps the coach and the trainer understand the possible structure. So, baka mamaya, dahil dito yung injury, alam nyo na kagad na yan ay isang fracture or yan ay isang sprain, no? So, the most painful area is usually the injury site. So, kung saan mo binibigyan ng pressure, halimbawa, ito yung masakit sa kanya, pero dito ka nakakita ng, dito dinidiinan mo yung pressure at sobrang sakit. So, yun yung tinatawag natin na injury site. The next one. The following questions can help in identifying the location and mechanism of injury. Siyempre, number one, what body part of the athlete needs support? So kung alin yung body part na kailangan ng suporta, baka nandun yung injury, ano? Then what body part can he or she not move or hindi niya magalaw? Did the athlete feel or hear any popping or snapping sound? Kasi kadalasan minsan, ang isang tao, siya lang yung nakakarinig na, halimbawa, pinatunog niya yung daliri niya, minsan siya lang yung nakakarinig niyan or nakakaramdam niyan. So was there a contact before the athlete complained or pain? Then lastly, what was the athlete doing before he or she complained of pain? So para malaman din natin yung cause of injury. Okay? Then identifying the type of pain also helps in identifying damaged tissues. The severity of the injury is usually related to the amount of pain experienced. So kung sobrang sakit, as in kahit nadikit pa lang yung, alimbawa, dinikit ko pa lang na ganyan, masakit na sobra. So makakatulong para malaman natin kung gaano kalala yung injury. So rank the pain, 1 being the lowest and 10 being the highest to reflect the amount of pain. Pwede natin silang tanungin, out of 10, gaano mo i-rate, no, gaano kasakit yung iyong injury. So this method is subjective and depends on the pain threshold of the person, and coach should be concerned if the pain scores higher than 6. So kung nagtanong ka dun sa player mo, tapos ang kanyang sagot ay 6 pataas, then kailangan na natin ng mag-seek ng medical help, no, kasi baka yun ay lalong lumala. Okay? Now for the kinds of pain, we have here different kinds of pain: acute pain, chronic, the breakthrough pain, the bone pain, soft tissue pain, the nerve pain, referred pain, phantom pain, and the total pain. So iisa-isahin natin ito para madali nating maintindihan. Acute pain, it starts suddenly and is short-term. Ibig sabihin, yung acute pain na yan is panandalian lang. No, hindi siya sobrang lala na type of injury. As in, makakaramdam ka lang ng saglit na sakit, pero mawawala din kagad. Okay? Let's say for example, pulikat. Diba? So yan yun, acute pain. Next one, chronic pain. It lasts for a longer period of time. So pag chronic, ibig sabihin, kabaligtaran siya ni acute, pang matagalan naman ito si chronic. Pag breakthrough pain naman, it often happens in between, no? Between regular and scheduled painkillers. So yan yung breakthrough pain. Then, we also have here the bone pain. So for the bone pain, it happens when cancer is affecting a bone. So yan yung mga nangyayari sa sa chemotherapy, no? Yung sinasabi nila na kapag ka may cancer ka, ay talagang tagos sa buto talaga yung sakit na nararamdaman nila. So soft tissue pain naman happens when organs, muscles, or tissues are damaged or inflamed, or yung namamaga, no? Then nerve pain, it happens when a nerve is damaged. Then the referred pain, it is when pain from one part of your body is felt in another part of your body. Then phantom pain is when there is pain in a part of the body that has been removed. And lastly, kumbaga sa phantom pain, yan yung may mga yung tinatawag natin na tapos na pero nararamdaman mo pa rin bigla yung sakit, no? So ganun yon. And for the total pain, it includes the emotional, social, and spiritual factors that affect a person's pain experience. So holistic, no? As in kabuuan, yun yung total pain. Now this is the PACES pain rating scale. So kung nakikita natin na ganito, ayan, pwede natin din tong gamitin, no, sa mga players. So pwede natin ipa-distinguish sa kanila kung gaano yung pain na kanilang nararamdaman. So we have no pain, discomforting, distressing, intense, utterly horrible, and unimaginable or unspeakable, no? So dito pa nga lang sa distressing, kailangan na nating mag-alala, of course, dun sa player natin. We also have here the gross motor movement. So ibig sabihin, malawakan, malakihang movement. This is the active component of the secondary survey, and it checks muscle weakness and joint stability. It helps the coach or trainer determine the severity of the injury. So yan yung gross motor movement. Now for gross motor check, ito yung mga dapat nating i-consider. Number 1, can the athlete move the injured limb on his or her own? So kaya niya bang gumalaw mag-isa? Can the athlete move his or her limb throughout its entire range of motion? So kung dati nagagawa niyang iikot ng maayos yung kamay niya, kaya pa rin ba niyang gawin kung sakaling yun yung point of injury? Can the athlete sustain the movement when resistance is applied? So kapag ka nagkakaroon ng pressure, kaya pa rin niya bang igalaw? Number 4, does the athlete limp when he or she walks? Iika-ika ba siya? And number 5, does the athlete have a problem balancing his or her weight? Hindi na makatayo dahil sa sobrang sakit. So yun yung mga pwede natin i-consider, no? Next one, passive and active. So passive component of the secondary survey will be able to rule out if there are injuries to the hard tissues. And for the active naman, active component will be able to identify if there are injuries to the soft tissue. Immediate care is focused on controlling inflammation. So again, yung passive natin, passive component of the secondary survey will be able to rule out if there are injuries to the hard tissues. And yung active naman natin is controlling or during, no? Controlling the inflammation of the injury. Now, for the immobilization, very important itong isang ito dahil with this, matutulungan natin na hindi lumala yung injury, no? So, marami tayong pwedeng gawin dito sa immobilization, which is yun nga, yung pag-i-splint ng injured part. So, first one, the rigid splint. So, it is made of tough materials such as wood, plastic, and plaster of pairs. So, yan yung sa rigid splint, no? So, ginagamitan natin yan ng mga materials para hindi gumalaw yung ating injured part. Soft splint naman, pwedeng newspaper, pillows, and air splints ang gamitin natin. For the anatomical splint, immobilization technique, wherein the object that restricts movement is another body part of the injured athlete. It depends on the available resource and the body part that got injured. So that is the immobilization. This is the rigid splint. Ayan, ginagamitan natin ng mga materials, no, or hard materials. For the soft splint, ito naman yung ginagamit natin karaniwan. Pwede rin dyan yung mga triangular bandage. And for the anatomical splint, ayan, as in no movements at all, no? Yan yung anatomical splint. Now, the principles of immobilization. First one is to immobilize the limb in the position that is least painful or in the position it was found. So, kung ano man yung position na nakita mo nung siya ina-injured, mas maganda na hindi na natin galawin. Okay? Secure lang natin na hindi siya magalaw kasi nga, kung yun ay magalaw, masakit para sa patient and at the same time, pwede magkaroon ng dagdag na injury. Then, number 2, take note of any changes in skin color, temperature, and sensation. Kung yung kulay nung balat ay, halimbawa, yun nga, nag-violet, nag-red, tapos umiinit yung kanyang katawan, yan, kailangan nating i-note yan. Number 3, include the joint above and below the fractured bone in the splint. So, syempre, para hindi rin magalaw. Leave fingers and toes uncovered, and then apply it firmly with this, without discomfort. And lastly, when using an elastic bandage, apply consistent tension. Hindi yung pag naglagay ka ng elastic bandage, sa una maluwag, tapos bigla mong sisikipan, tapos luluwag ulit. So, hindi pwedeng ganun. Okay? Then, we have here the cervical arm sling. Ayan. To secure, no? To secure yung arms natin. It is positioned between the body and the injured arm. So, the elbow usually bent at 90 degrees. No, angle, katulad na itong nasa picture, ayan, 90 degrees. Ito, this one. No? So, the base of the bandage is positioned near the fingers, which is this one, yung pinakang gitna ng triangular bandage. So, yan yung paglalagay natin ng triangular bandage para gumawa ng cervical arm sling. So, splinting basics can be ready-made or can be made from basic materials. Make sure na yung pang-splint natin, syempre, ay malinis. For example, a person could use a branches, no? Yung mga sanga-sanga, kung sakali mang nandun kayo sa gubat, pwede natin gamitin yun, ilagay dito. Halimbawa, ito yung injured part, itali natin dito, pwede po yun, no? Make sure na walang tusok-tusok lang, ano? Yung boards, pwede rin. Layers of cardboard or a foam sleeping pad. Wrapping materials for the splint can include bandanas or yun nga, yung mga triangular bandage, no? So, climbing webbing, torn shirts, pants, or other pieces of clothing that is clean. So, this material should be wrapped completely around the splinted extremity to secure the splint, but should not be so tight as to block circulation. So, wag naman yung hihigpitan nyo ng sobra. Kasi kapag hinigpitan nyo ng sobra, hindi naman dadaloy ng maayos yung dugo. Okay? So, a basic rule of splinting is that the joint above and below the broken bone should be immobilized to protect the fracture site. So for example, if the lower leg is broken, the splint should immobilize both the ankle and the knee. So kailangan natin consider yon dahil nga kung may joint tayo, syempre magagalaw pa rin natin yon. So halimbawa, itong kamay natin yung na-injured. So ang i-secure natin is itong arms natin tsaka yung forearm natin. As in buong kamay or buong braso is secured natin. Kasi kapag ka ito lang, magagalaw pa rin natin to. No? So kailangan natin i-secure yon kapag ka ang injury ay nasa joints. So upper extremity splinting, the arm, shoulder, elbow, the wrist and finger. So using bandages to create a sling works for immobilizing collarbone, shoulder and upper arm injuries extending down to the elbow. So the arm sling is wrapped to the person's body with a large bandage encircling the person's chest. So yan yung gagawin natin kapag ka ang injury ay nasa upper extremity. Okay? Next one, injury to the forearm. Ito nga, forearm natin. Yan, this one. And wrist requires a straight supportive splint that secures and aligns both sides of the injury. So, an open hardback book is a quick and handy temporary immobilizer. So, kung meron tayong libro, pwede rin yun. Cardboard, pwede rin yun. Just for us to make sure that our forearm is stable. No? So, yan yun. Then, kapag ka naman ang injured part ay leg, knee, ankle, foot, pelvis, and hips. So, ito naman yung dapat nating gawin. Immobilize or completely immobilize the person. So, because broken bones of the pelvis, which is yung ating nasa side ng ating reproductive system, no, and upper leg can cause massive, life-threatening, and internal bleeding. So, people with these types of fractures should be evacuated unless splinting and carriage are absolutely necessary. Okay, so very important ito dahil it can be a life-threatening situation. So in these cases, the splint should extend to the lower back and down past the knee, the affected side of the extremity. So ankle injuries and foot injuries can be wrapped alone. Use a figure of 8 pattern under the foot, over the top of the foot. So we have some videos on how to splint, no, yung ating foot or yung ating ankles. So yun. Again, the main objective in splinting is for us to immobilize the part of the injured part, no? So yun lang yung pinakang ano natin dot objective. So now, what are the practical ways of controlling inflammation? So first one, let's define inflammation. So inflammation is the first step of the healing process. Yun nga, yung namamaga. No, so which increases blood flow to the injured area. So that's why medyo namumula yung kanyang kulay. So study shows that the healing period is directly related to the degree of swelling. The swelling of the injured part should be controlled in order to move the healing process to the next phase. So we have here the PRICE principle. P for protect, of course protect the injured part. R for rest, kailangan nating ipahinga. I for ice, no? So, pwede rin tayo mag-ice compression. C for compression, or yun nga, after icing to further prevent swelling, wrap natin yung injured area with an elastic bandage for us to secure again or immobilize the part. And the last one is elevation. So, elevate natin yung to the level of heart or above allows for excess fluid be pumped back. So, for example, yung kamay natin yung injured part, elevate lang natin yung kamay natin, no, para dumaloy ng maayos yung dugo sa puso natin. So yan yung PRICE principle, PRICE. Then for the guidelines, number 1, position the initial layers at the far end of the injury and move upward. So yun yung unang step na dapat nating gawin. Then second one is to apply the bandage in a way that the limb is pulled toward the opposite direction of how the limb was injured, no, para yun nga ma-secure natin yung position nung injured part. Number 3 is body part should be wrapped in the position of largest girth. Number 4, it is best to apply more turn with moderate tension. 5 is to standardize the tension and overlap each turn by half of the previous layer. And number 6, keep the toes and fingers visible in order to check if blood flow is restricted. So, yung kamay natin, pag tayo ay magbabalot, make sure na yung fingers is nakalabas, no? Or yung paa natin, yung toes natin is nakalabas. Para makita natin yung kung nagkakaroon ng discoloration yung paa, na makita natin kung meron pang blood flow, okay? So, yun yung guidelines natin. Now, management of chronic injuries or yung mga pangmatagalang injuries nga differs from acute injuries dahil nga yung onset of swelling and pain is different. So, for us to manage the chronic injuries, yung acute injuries have a sudden onset of pain as in mabilisan lang, no, or gradual onset of pain. The prolonged inflammation that occurs in chronic or overuse injuries cannot be managed by the PRICE principle. Yung acute injuries, pwede pa natin gamitan ng PRICE principle yun eh. No, yung protect, rest, ice, compression, and elevation. Pero dito sa chronic injuries, talagang kailangan na nito ng pahinga. As in, no? So the strategy for alleviating inflammation in overuse injuries depend on its severity. So kailangan na talaga nating pumunta sa doktor at magpa-check up pag ito ang meron tayo. So the stages of chronic injuries, stage 1 is yung mild pa lang. Nagkaroon tayo ng overuse, no, injuries that are managed by reducing the workload and performing corrective exercises. So kapag tayo ay merong mild chronic injury, pwede lang nating bawasan yung load natin, pwede tayong magpaturo ng tamang exercise, no? So yan yung sa stage 1. Stage 2 natin is overuse injuries, usually complain when pain becomes intolerable or as in medyo hindi na natin makaya yung sakit, no? So that is stage 2. So for the chronic injuries, ayan, athletes with severe overuse injury would be recommended to cease training. So yan yung mga nakikita natin, 'di ba? Sa PBA, sa volleyball, kapag ka ang players is na-injured, ang nangyayari, pinapagpahinga sila ng 3 months, 5 months to years, no? Depende sa severity ng injury. So yan yun. Kailangan ng pahinga sa chronic injuries. Then, bleeding or infection. The priority care for wounds is to control bleeding. Tatandaan natin, bleeding is also life-threatening, is also a life-threatening situation. Lalo na kapag sobra-sobra yung pagdurugo na nararanasan ng pasyente. So, pwede nating makontrol yung bleeding sa paglalagay ng pressure over the wound. So, kung ang sugat ko ay nandito, no? So, pwede akong kumuha ng malinis na tela, tatakpan ko lang siya ng ganyan, okay? Para tumigil yung pagdurugo. So, do it for 10 minutes. Necessary before checking for blood clot formation over the wound. So, yung tourniquets that are effective in controlling blood loss, but it is only performed as a last resort when bleeding has not stopped through conservative strategies. So, yan yung bleeding or infection. The question is, can a person die from losing too much blood? And obviously, the answer is yes. Okay? So, the average blood volume of a person is 5 liters. So, ganun karami yung average blood volume ng isang tao. So, a person who loses more than 20% of blood would be weak and has high risk of infection. So, nababawasan yung number or yung bilang ng dugo. Yun nga, naglo-low blood. No, nababawasan yung hemoglobin. Yan. So, yan yung mga nangyayari. A person who loses more than 30% of total blood volume is at risk of developing shock. So, yung shock natin, yan nga yung mga nag-lead din sa heart attack, sa mga impaired circulation, yung mga ganyan. And the person, right after that, can die. So, pansinin ninyo, ang isang tao, kapag ka nagkaroon ng open wound, no, syempre, nagdudugo yun dahil open wound nga. At siya ay ooperahan. Let's say, for example, kailangan siyang operahan. Hindi siya pwedeng operahan hanggat meron pang way yung dugo na mag-flow ng mag-flow. Halimbawa, ang isang tao or ang isang pasyente ay may open wound, nagdudugo yun. No? Siyempre, pagka inoperahan, magdudugo lalo yun. No? So, mas mababawasan ng dugo yung tao. And then, ano pa? Halimbawa, nagsuka yung tao ng dugo. So, pwede rin yun. So, kapag nagsuka siya ng dugo, mababawasan din yung dugo sa katawan. So, ang masakit nun, kapag during operation, syempre, because of operation, maglalabas ng dugo yung tao, tapos bigla pang nagsuka ng dugo. So, you can lose too much blood sa situation na yun. And, yun ang mahirap, kasi pwedeng ikamatay talaga ng tao. That's why, bago pa man sumalang sa operation, ay chinecheck muna ng doctor kung yung kanyang blood pressure is stable, no? Kung hindi at kung mababa yung kanyang hemoglobin count, ay magsasalin ng dugo, no? Yung doctor dun sa pasyente para ma-secure na magiging sapat yung dugo ng pasyente during operation. Okay? So that is losing too much blood. So it's important to act fast and recognize the signs and symptoms of shock, such as 1, rapid but weak pulse rate. Okay? 2, cool and clammy skin or malamig, lumalamig yung kanyang balat. 3, pale or bluish lips, namumutla yung kanyang labi. 4 is rapid and shallow breathing. So, nagahabol ng hininga. And then, for the heat stroke, we already discussed this one on our previous topic. So, yung heat stroke, dahil nga yan dun sa tinatawag nating exposure, no, sa strong heat. No? So, yan yung heat stroke. And dahil yan na sa dehydration. Okay? Siyempre, kapag tayo ay dehydrated, yung dugo natin becomes more viscous, which means that the heart has to generate more force to circulate. So, yan yung nangyayari sa heat stroke. Again, pwede to sa mga young to adults. No? Walang pinipili ito. So, heat stroke guidelines, 1, para mailigtas natin yung pasyente no, mula sa heat stroke, seek shelter that is cold away from the sun. So, kung meron man tayong mga shaded area or air-conditioned area, maganda na ilipat natin yung pasyente doon. 2, replenish fluids and electrolytes. So, kung ang pasyente natin ay conscious, pwede natin siyang painumin ng tubig. Pero kung hindi naman, kuha tayo ng tubig, kuha tayo ng panyo, basain natin yung panyo, tapos itap natin sa katawan ng pasyente para mag-cool down yung pasyente. 3, stretch the muscle tendon until experiencing cramps. 4 is decrease body temperature by loosening clothing. So, para bumaba yung kanyang temperature, luwagan natin yung kanyang mga suot. Then, yun nga, punasan natin ng cool towel, maglagay tayo ng ice pack over the head or sa neck. Then 5, check body temperature and pulse rate regularly every 1 minute. Tapos elevate natin or itaas natin yung kanyang paa, no, para dumaloy ulit yung dugo papunta sa kanyang puso. So bring the closest medical facilities, okay, of course, for intravenous fluid replacement when temperature is above 40 degrees Celsius. So kapag sobrang taas na ng kanyang temperature, so make sure to bring the person to a medical facility. Do not give anti-fever medications or caffeinated drinks to the person. Kasi nga, lalo lang magtataas no, yung kanyang temperature pag binigyan natin itong mga ito. And that is our discussion no, for week 4 of the second semester. So again, that is the injury, no? Our topic is all about the injury management. So, yun yung diniscuss natin ngayon. So, marami tayong natutunan dito sa discussion na ito on how are we going to manage sports injury. So, ano yung mga first aid na dapat natin gawin pag tayo ay pag tayo ay naka-encounter ng isang player no, na na-injured or tayo mismo yung na-injured. So, very important itong discussion na to dahil nga sobrang makakatulong ito on how are we going to manage the injury no, para hindi lumala, para yun nga, hindi maging chronic injury at kung ano-ano pa. Malaman natin kung ano yung mga dapat natin gawin pag tayo is naka-experience ng injury. Okay? So, with that, I'm going to end this session with, of course, a thank you for listening and watching this video. And yeah, if you want to request any topics or lesson in MAPEH in high school, or PN Health in senior high school and PE in college, you can just type it down dun sa ating comment box, and I'm going to create another video lesson for that specific topic na desired mo. So yun lang. Thank you so much once again for listening, and